Counsel Daniel Sheehan and Cliff Kincaid from Accuracy in Media.
Danny Sheehan, if you pick up the newspapers in Washington, you see articles which references the Christic Institute. You're chief counsel of that organization. Would you spend 1 minute telling us what the group does?
Yeah, the Christic Institute, Susan, is a public interest law firm and public policy center that's recognized by the Internal Revenue Service as a charitable tax-exempt organization that's existed since 1980. We're a group that was put together by the people who investigated and prosecuted the Karen Silkwood case back in 1979 against the Kerr-McGee Nuclear Corporation, and the same group that has done the number of pieces of litigation at Three Mile Island to stop the company from pumping the radioactive water into the river, for example. And we work with the church groups, the church and synagogue groups around the country, their social ministry organizations, to investigate public policy issues and to bring pieces of litigation that can resolve certain factual questions, because until you have the facts pretty well established in some given public policy area, you can't really begin to debate the moral values or the different views that people have. It doesn't do any good to argue about facts. You have to bring the evidence to show facts and to then have the people convicted, if that is the decision of the jury, and then move on to the Congress and the people of the country decide what should we do about this public policy problem given the facts.
Good evening from Washington. Thanks for being with us. We're going to spend an hour this evening talking about two things. First of all, to learn about the Christic Institute. As I mentioned, it has been in the news frequently in the past few weeks. And we've had lots of calls on our call-in programs about the group. And we thought we would spend some time finding out from someone deeply involved in it what it does. We also are going to talk about some of the issues that the Christic Institute is involved in. And we've got a second guest in our studio this evening to do that. Cliff Kincaid is a columnist. He is also director of media analysis for the Accuracy in Media, a group located here in Washington, D.C. We'll be getting to Mr. Kincaid in just a few minutes. I want to start with issues. If you had to explain what kind of issues your organization was involved in, have you been focusing recently on specific certain issues, all of your energies going into one area?
Well, recently, Susan, we've been working very specifically on the issue of representing the ABC television cameraman, a man by the name of Tony Avergon, who was one of the victims of a bombing down in Nicaragua back on Memorial Day of 1984. He and a number of other people, two dozen people, were severely wounded, and a number of journalists were killed in this attack against Eden Pastora. A young woman named Melinda Frazier, an American journalist, and a number of others were killed. We have been working on investigating that to ascertain who committed the bombing, who was involved in supplying them, and what that represents as a matter of public policy. We were, in fact, the group that first formally informed Congress about the existence of this secret network that was providing military equipment to the Contras during the Boland Amendment. We're the first group that brought formal charges against Richard Secord and Albert Hakim and the number of people that were involved in what they now refer to as the enterprise, the private, off-the-shelf, standalone, self-financing organization that has been prosecuting its own foreign policy, basically, independent of oversight by Congress. And we wanted the facts to be brought to bear and then have a decision made with regard to the law as to the legality of their conduct, and then to have a debate among the people in the United States and in Congress to determine whether or not this policy should be allowed to go forward or whether new legislation was needed to stop this type of conduct.
So through these several lawsuits, is it fair to say that your organization has been concentrating on the Contra aid issue in the past few years?
Well, it's just one lawsuit, that particular lawsuit. We had said since our inception, we've been involved in things primarily determined by the religious public policy offices, the Union of American Hebrew Congregations, the Jesuit National Office of Social Ministry, the Methodists, and others. They come to a certain collective discernment as to what the major public policy problem is. And what we do at the Christic Institute is attempt to investigate this, to develop facts, and then define what the issues are in a way that the American people can understand so that we can have a debate and a resolution of these policy problems.
Where do you get your funding?
From a lot of the religious organizations, their social ministry offices, from most of it's from direct mail. We send out letters to people and inform them of what the information is, ask them to send in $25, $50 to support the litigation. Everybody at the Christic Institute, we only earn $15,000 a year, everybody from the top to the bottom. The money goes into financing investigation through independent private investigators and for depositions, sworn depositions and court record.
If you had to describe any political stance of the organization, is there one?
Well, it's interesting that we've been, what we're characterized as, is that we're considered to be considerably more progressive than radicals and considerably more traditional than conservatives, because we come out of a Judeo-Christian ethical stance. Sometimes you end up being on a position where the right wing believes that your positions are too radical, and sometimes the progressive community considers our positions too traditionalist. And also people say that we're about as far right as anybody on the left will talk to, and about as far left as anybody on the right will talk to. So we end up being sort of in the middle of a lot of these issues. But for the most part, the only people who get extremely exercised about our operation are people who end up as defendants in our lawsuits. The Kerr McGee Nuclear Corporation, the corporation over in Pennsylvania, the Ku Klux Klan, an American Nazi party that we prosecuted down in Greensboro, North Carolina for killing a number of demonstrators down there. And of course, their organs, that usually these are major public policy groups such as the Klan or Nazis, and they have their own public education organs, and they engage in hyperbole in the extreme about who we are and what we represent. I think that's why we have Mr. Kincaid here this evening, so that his accuracy, if you will, in media organization can express their views about the Christic Institute, too.
Let's turn to Mr. Kincaid. First of all, do you agree with the general description that we heard of the organization?
No. I didn't frankly understand it. He talks about being in the middle of the issues, progressive, traditional. The Christic Institute is probably best known for this lawsuit against the secret team. But what Danny Sheehan forgets to mention is they claim there's a massive conspiracy that's been operating for decades involving a secret team running U.S. foreign policy, engaging in drug smuggling, gun running, plotting political assassinations. I've written an article for Human Events calling their lawsuit nothing but legal terrorism, because they have focused on individuals, innocent people, dragging them through the courts whose only crime, so to speak, has been to either serve their country in the military, serve their country in the intelligence community, or help the Nicaraguan freedom fighters. He's had this lawsuit going for 18 months. He has yet to produce any evidence to back it up. He refuses to identify his sources, except for a few, including someone who's now supposedly dead or who may never have even existed. And I think it's a disgrace. He's dragging these defendants through costly litigation, costing millions of dollars. It's political warfare by an organization, the Christic Institute, that joined with the Communist Party in sponsoring the demonstration against Central American policy last April, and whose staffers write for pro-communist publications. It's interesting, according to the Iran-Contra reports, that Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North had asked the FBI to investigate whether the Christic Institute lawsuit was being secretly financed by the Sandinistas or some other hostile foreign government. The FBI refused to investigate, but I think an investigation is called for.
Mr. Sheehan.
Joe McCarthy, we have here. That's the level of analysis of accuracy in media. You know, it's just new McCarthyism. You know, to say that these people are innocent people, like Richard Secord, who's getting ready to be criminally indicted, you know, Albert Hakim, who everybody realizes is a basic embezzler of millions of dollars from U.S. military foreign policy programs. You know, I don't know what to say about that. You know, the fact is that if anybody wants to analyze the stuff, it's just like Kerr McGee said, that somehow we were just, when we were suing them on the Silkwood case, that they were totally innocent. They didn't know anything about what we were talking about, that we must somehow be sponsored by communists. See, it's their favorite thing. They ended up being found guilty of a $10.5 million judgment on behalf of Karen Silkwood's children, and moaned and groaned all the way to the bank. That's the same thing that we've got going here. You know, that accuracy in the media, you know, was funded by Richard Mellon Scaife and Coors, guys who have spent hundreds of thousands, indeed millions of dollars, supplying military equipment to the Contras. And they've hired a paid-for organ, such as Accuracy Media, to come out and try to trash anybody that disagrees with them. We're willing to go to court and prove what we've said. We've done it in every case we've ever done. We've never lost a single one of our cases. Mm-hmm. We've prosecuted the people in the courts and convicted them, and we're going to do it for these people, too.
Let me read you a paragraph in Mr. Kincaid's article and get your response to it. This is from the November 28th Human Events. The Christic lawyers, and he's quoting one of your defendants, Tom Posey of Civilian Material Assistance. The Christic lawyers, he says, are, quote, trying to kill private sector aid to the Contras because they know that if they can kill us, the Congress is going to cut off the other aid. And if the Contras are going to be left out on a limb with it sawed off and nobody to help them. Is that, would you respond to that?
The simple fact is that the operations of the Contras are criminal racketeering enterprises. You know, they've been declared so by the World Court. The response of President Reagan was to withdraw the United States from the World Court. They're going to be declared to be so by the Federal District Court in Miami. You know, that these people are the 14 of the 15 military commanders for them are the former LaGuardia commanders for Anastasio Somoza. Ask Mr. Kincaid what he thinks about Somoza, what a great hero he was for his people, even though everybody in the entire country ended up opposing him as a vicious dictator. But not Mr. Kincaid, and not General Singlaub, and not Richard Secord, not any of these people. They just happen to have a particular ideology that, you know, that characterized Joe McCarthy, and now they're back, you know.
I guess it's McCarthyite to refer to real and actual communist activities. I have the literature right here that backs up everything I say.
And all the names of the communists in the State Department.
I'm willing to produce it to anybody who's interested. I wish Mr. Sheehan would be just as willing to put up the evidence that backs up his wild conspiracy theories. He reminds me of Lyndon LaRouche, who claims that the Queen of England is pushing drugs. It's so bizarre, but you have to take it seriously. And you have to understand the purpose is, as Tom Posey said, to kill aid to the Nicaraguan freedom fighters. He has gone after people like Richard Secord, who did provide needed support when the Congress didn't act for the Nicaraguan freedom fighters.
And his lawyers swore in court that he didn't.
He's going
until
after. He was involved in a covert operation.
Yeah, criminal
he's
enterprise.
Going after General Singlaub, another supporter of the freedom fighters. Rob Owen, who was Colonel North's liaison, who risked everything to help freedom in Nicaragua. Adolfo Calero was another defendant. And these people kept the freedom fighting movement alive in Nicaragua when the Congress refused to act. And Mr. Sheehan here wants to kill the freedom fighters and wants to tie these people up in expensive litigation, and it's a crime.
Okay, let's hold it at that point, Mr. Sheehan. I want our viewers to join in. We have 45 minutes to take our viewer calls. Our telephone number is at the bottom of the screen. Many of our regular viewers have already begun dialing in, and we will go to the phone lines. If you have called within the past 30 days, however, hold off. Let other people have a chance to get their questions in this evening. Let's go to Natick, Massachusetts first. Good evening.
Yes, I was wondering what the guests would think about the media coverage of the scandal when it seems as if this issue, Iran-Contra, really has been put on the back burner in the newspaper, and they've been sort of desperate to expose create other scandals like the Hart scandal, which broke on the very day that the hearings were to begin. where the Biden scandal, which was also sort of directed at the Bork nomination. But as far as the fairness of the media, as far as keeping attention to something that's a very serious problem in the country, because it seems to me as if this group called the Axion Media really is not very much concerned with corruption in the media.
Okay.
There is widespread corruption in the media. We've got you've got the guest right there, and I'd like to just direct some questions to the Axion Media guest.
All right, sir. I'm going to let you go with the general issue. We've got so many calls on the line. Appreciate it, and thank you. General comments on news coverage of the issue.
Well, it's interesting, Susan, that when the Christic Institute filed the lawsuit back in May of 1986, we explained and set out in great detail what the information was about the people, about the enterprise, its violation of certain laws that made them a federal racketeering organization, described, named the individuals, the role they played. In fact, as I think Mr. Kincaid will concede, when Robert Dutton was being interrogated on national television during the Iran-Contra hearings, they said that, he said specifically that Oliver North and General Secord had become convinced that the Christic Institute's information was so accurate that it must be Felix Rodriguez that was the source for them on this. And, and he was one of the main supply officers for the Contras. And every single time one of our sources has been named, they have gone after them. Oliver North has gotten the head of the anti-terrorist division of the FBI, Buck Revell, to go after them. They've gone into places where they were, for example, with Peter Glibbery, who was in jail down in Costa Rica, threatened them, forced them to sign statements. You know, they've done it over and over again. That the fact of the matter is that they view themselves as entitled to use any type of illegal activity that they deem necessary to suppress this information. And they said so. They said that the reason that they went after the Christic Institute is because the Christic Institute threatened to knock out their supply operation. Now, the fact is that all of that information was being put out by the Christic Institute. None of it was being covered by the national media. All they did is they said they want to, tell me who your source is so I can go talk to them. And I was saying, here are the facts. Here are the men that are involved in the operation. Here's what they're doing. Go find out. You've got millions of dollars of time and energy. Go find it out.
Mr. Kincaid, let's stay with the general question of the viewer.
I'd like to respond specifically. I will grant this. The Institute's lawsuit, which was filed in May of 1986, several months before the Iran-Contra operations broke, was accurate in naming certain participants in the Iran-Contra operations, such as General Secord, Rob Owen, and so forth. Now, the question is, how did the Christic Institute get these names, which were not publicly known at the time? And General Secord has suggested, and I think it's worthy of an investigation, that these names were obtained through communications intercepts at the Soviet intelligence facility at Lourdes, Cuba. And this information was provided via communist channels to the plaintiffs and or the Christic Institute. So I'd like to find out where those names came from. Mr. Sheehan, of course, won't reveal his sources. He has refused to for 18 months. For 18 months, he has refused to back up the evidence.
Cliff, let me ask you when the last time was you looked at one of the pleadings in this case.
Today.
Oh, really? Then how did you miss the fact that we provided 45 names of all the witnesses and given their numbers and stuff out of the affidavit? Did you miss that entirely?
45 names for what? For a massive conspiracy extending over 25 years?
The names of the sources in detail to describe what it is they provided to us and who they were and when we got the information. All you have to do is read the pleadings.
Well, I certainly will look at your sources, because I understand some of them claim they didn't tell you what you said they told you.
Okay, let's stop at this point. Go to Seattle, Washington next. Good evening.
Thank you. It's nice to see you, Dan. I just want to say that I support the truth that you're endeavoring to bring forth. And also in response to Cliff Kincaid, I think that if the only thing you do accomplish is cutting off aid to the Nicaraguan terrorists, I think, it's a worthy cause. And also PBS had a program on secret government that went back and detailed what you've been looking into. I don't know if you're aware of that. It's very excellent.
Okay.
Yes, that's the Bill Moyer show. It was on November 4th of 1987, called The Secret Government, Our Constitution in Crisis. I'm sure, of course, Cliff Kincaid would assume that Bill Moyers is also a communist, and that he must be getting his information, of course, from the Communist Party. The fact of the matter is that we entered a period, a few years ago, when when the same kind of McCarthyist kind of stuff has been going on, that, that the president thinks everybody's a communist who happens to oppose his war policies. Now, the fact of the matter is we saw this in our history, and the fact is we've all come to a judgment as to what this McCarthyism is all about. They got nothing better to do than to say, well, they must be in direct communication with the Soviet embassy to get this information. The fact of the matter is that this information was available if the national media wanted to investigate it. All we've done is investigated it, followed it through, talked to people, and proven what's gone on here.
Well, the point is that who benefits from this lawsuit? Who benefits are the Sandinistas, the Cubans, and the Soviets in Central America?
In the American Constitution,
because
which they don't hold in high regard.
It's interesting to note that Mr. Sheehan here, while he's been pursuing this lawsuit, which is designed to end private sector aid to the Nicaraguan freedom fighters, a group that he used to be associated with called the Quixote Center has been spearheading the Quest for Peace, which is a drive to send tens of millions of dollars to the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. So if Mr. Sheehan has his way, private sector aid to the Nicaraguan freedom fighters is going to be cut off, but private sector aid to the Sandinistas is going to continue.
Very quick rebuttal.
Well, what you have to understand, Cliff, is that one is a criminal operation that's been so designated by the World Court. Another one is a national government. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. People are perfectly straightforward. The Quixote Center, you know, announces it to the whole world in church meetings, in congregational meetings, that they're sending medical supplies and stuff to the people who are being attacked by the Contras in Nicaragua. It's a perfectly legal and above board operation. The operation that you're here to defend is a criminal conspiracy that's going to have men going to federal prison. They're being indicted by special prosecutors. They've been condemned by a joint select committee as being people who held the Constitution in absolute disregard, and they're involved in a criminal conspiracy. And that's what they're going to pay for.
Well, let me just add quickly, there has been no evidence that what Colonel North or General Secord or the others did was a criminal conspiracy. Mr. Mm-hmm. Sheehan certainly hasn't proved it. In fact, if they are indicted by a special prosecutor, leaving aside his conspiracy
right.
lawsuit, they are going to be able to produce much evidence showing that what they did to help the Nicaraguan freedom fighters was within the law and in accordance with presidential policy.
Good evening.
They're going to be given their chance.
Dallas, Texas, you're on the air.
Good evening. Hello?
Your question, sir.
Yes, I have a comment about the media in general, which applies to both gentlemen.
Okay.
I think, you know, in the past, slavery used to be physical abduction. Today, basically, you abduct human beings' thinking and attitude and behavior. There are 2 points I would like to mention to the gentleman, which is the Israeli role in the Contra, in the Iran-Contra affair, and also the painting picture of the Sandinista as a communist. If the Sandinista are communists, so is most of the European countries. You know, being socialist, not necessarily being a communist. You have, in France, you have a socialist government. In Italy, you have a socialist government. Basically, everywhere in Europe, there is a socialist thinking, ideology.
Okay. Thank you for the call, sir. Appreciate it.
Well, look, the Sandinistas, at least their top leaders, are self-proclaimed Marxist-Leninists. Daniel Ortega himself, the Nicaraguan dictator, was present for Gorbachev's 70th anniversary speech and was seen applauding wildly. So the Sandinistas are part of the worldwide communist movement, a fact that I think escapes Mr. Sheehan here.
Mr. Sheehan?
Well, the simple fact is that anyone who bothers reading books, Cliff, knows that in fact there's a coalition government down there, and that there are Marxists in the government. There's not any question about that. And it's perfectly legal. They were democratically elected members of the coalition. The fact of the matter is that the activities on the part of the Contras, undertaking terrorist attacks against the peasants and the civilians there, are in fact strengthening the hand of those people that are Marxists inside the coalition and the government. People have talked about that. We've testified to Congress about that. If you had to draw up a blueprint as to how to strengthen the hands of Marxists in El Salvador, in Nicaragua, and other places, your clientele are doing the exact thing. They couldn't be paid to do anything better than to strengthen the hands of the Marxists there. They do not allow a democracy to flourish down there when they allow the Marxists to argue that they have to have national security state protections against these military assaults on them. It's silly if they would, if they're, and they will, of course, they'll be cut back and they'll be ordered to stop doing this. And you're going to start to see democratic processes flourish down there, as they would have if, in fact, these military commanders of Somoza had left them alone to start with.
I can see I'm going to have to make my answers longer so I get equal time. Let me just say this. The administration began its support of the Nicaraguan freedom fighters after evidence was unearthed showing that the Sandinistas were supplying weapons and other material to
That's
the El Salvadoran communist guerrillas.
To say something like
and,
that.
And Daniel Ortega himself admitted this fact in an interview with the Mexico newspaper earlier this year. So we acted to support freedom in Nicaragua when we had concrete evidence that the Sandinistas were trying to export communist revolution.
This man must be coming from a different planet, because the man who ran the investigation for CIA to see if there was any evidence whatsoever of those types of accusations, it's a man by the name of David McMichaels. He filed a report saying there was absolutely no evidence whatsoever to support a preposterous accusation like that. In fact, he came out and held press conferences when the administration wouldn't acknowledge that. In fact, he works for the Christic Institute right now.
Okay, let's hold right there and let's go to Albuquerque, New Mexico. You're on the air.
I'd like to ask Mr. Sheehan a question unrelated to the Sandinistas and the Contras.
All right, go ahead, sir.
A large portion of his aid apparently comes from the churches. There was a recent terrorist act in Northern Ireland, just, I think, one of a number.
Yes, I saw it.
It's been shown that a great deal of the aid for the IRA is coming from the United States. Is the Christic Foundation investigating this to see if there is some possibility of some suits?
The fact of the matter is that the Christic Institute has not been contacted by anyone to ask us to investigate that. We were contacted by the Catholic bishop down in southern Texas at his office back in March of 1984 to investigate and to defend the church workers that were being prosecuted and were eventually, all the charges were dismissed against them, by the way, for transporting people from El Salvador in Guatemala to come to apply for sanctuary. It was in the context of those of being retained to do that that we uncovered this information about the gun smuggling that was going on down to Ilopango. That's why we became involved in that, and then we were contacted by the ABC television cameraman, Tony Avergon, and asked to represent him to bring a lawsuit against the people who bombed him. Now, the fact of the matter is it's a terrible tragedy what's going on in Ireland, all throughout Ireland. In fact, you've seen the bishops, the Catholic bishops, have condemned it uniformly. And that if, in fact, the Catholic bishops and the Protestant bishops and the Union of American Hebrew Congregations leadership were to contact us and ask us to pursue an investigation of that, we would be more than delighted to do so. And we do when we're contacted and asked to do things like that.
Birmingham, Alabama, you're on the air. Good evening.
Good evening. I would like to speak with Mr. Sheehan.
Okay, go ahead.
Mr. Sheehan, I'm so terribly happy about every word you said. And I knew you would be attacked by communism, because they have no other defense. Just for a word. I've been called this too, and I ask people to define it, and they don't even know. Right on. Congratulations.
Okay, thank you for the
Well, point. I'd like to respond to that, because he's implied, has stated that somehow my allegations about communism are without foundation. This is a list of the sponsors of the Mobilization for Justice and Peace in Central America, which was a demonstration against U.S. policy of support for the Nicaraguan freedom fighters. You can see the Christic Institute is listed as a sponsor together with the Communist Party.
Would you like to read some of the other sponsors?
Can I finish? The Communist Party is a sponsor. Here I've got a newsletter of the Christian Peace Conference, which is identified Soviet front organization, which has an article by Andrew Lang, who happens to serve as a staffer, at the Christic Institute. Isn't Andrew Lang on your staff?
Andrew Lang is on our staff.
And he has written for a Soviet Front Group newsletter. Here is an interview from the People's Daily World, the Communist Party newspaper, an interview with Reverend Bob Davis of the Christic Institute. Doesn't he work for you? Mr. Davis works for you, doesn't he?
It's not Bob Davis. It's Father Bill Davis.
Father Bill
He's
Davis.
He's the former director of the Jesuit National Social Ministry Office.
All right.
That's right.
Here we got the Peace Courier, newsletter of the World Peace Council, another identified Soviet front organization glorifying the Christic Institute lawsuit. Who serves, who benefits from the Christic Institute litigation, the communists.
Okay, while you're looking at that, we're going to take another phone call, Mr. Sheehan. Mm-hmm. We'll let you get back to that. Fullerton, California, sure. You're on the air.
Yes, I just have two things I wanted to ask.
Okay.
First of all, I wondered if the churchgoers of America, the people who belong to Middle America and churches affiliated with the World Council of Churches or the Roman Catholic Church, realize that the money they drop in their collection plates every Sunday may well be going to Mr. Sheehan's organization, and little is known about it, even as he speaks to us. We still don't know a whole lot about that organization and where he stands.
Let me interrupt for a second. The purpose of this program is to find out more about the organization. If you have some specific questions, fire away.
Okay. The other thing is that I just wanted to comment on the language that Mr. Sheehan uses, which is the typical catchwords of the left, McCarthyism, illegal, racketeering, using all kinds of smear words, and especially the word, though, progressive, I want to comment on, because I think whenever anyone uses the word progressive, people should stop and say, progressing toward what? Because, anyone can claim to be progressive, but that word in and of itself does not denote something good, necessarily.
Okay. Let me ask you, we have a lot of callers. Do you have a specific question you want to ask about the group?
No, that's it.
All right, thank you for the call. Mr. Sheehan.
Okay, yeah, the question, progressive toward what? Progressive toward enforcing the federal racketeering laws, progressive toward enforcing the United States Constitution. I'm going to say, when Bill Moyers comes on national television for 90 minutes, points out the names of these same defendants over and over again, Singlaub, Secord, Hakim, all of these people, and point out that these people are engaged in a cabal to set aside basically the Constitution of the United States because they place higher value on their providing military equipment to some group of people who are former military commanders for Somoza than they do the United States Constitution. And they come on and lie to Congress. They destroy evidence. It doesn't take a radical person to demand that something be done about these people. This is enforcing basically the basic values of the stuff that we're taught in high school civics courses, and they call everybody communists.
Well, let me add
the Amalgamated Clothing and Textile Workers Union, right? The Coalition of Labor Union Women in Washington D.C., the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the chaplain at Howard University, the Episcopal Anglican chaplain. These are the people that have been sponsors of these types of marches and things. And all see is that typical thing that anybody who ends up sponsoring a march here in Washington to oppose financing to the Contras has got to be a communist.
Okay.
And that's their position.
Well, I didn't say that. I said that some of his staffers have written for communist publications and that his organization was a co-sponsor with the Communist Party of a demonstration. I didn't say that they were communists specifically.
Would you like to say that?
I'm just trying to provide information. I think we believe the public has a right to know. And I don't think there should be a taboo against talking about actual communist activities in this country, because the communists do exist. They have a communist party. The chairman of the Communist Party was at that party in Moscow with Danny Ortega and Mikhail Gorbachev. So I'm just trying to get information out. And I came into this area, I wrote my article for Human Events about the Christic Institute's legal terrorism, as I call it, because I was alarmed by the charges. They were claiming a massive conspiracy over decades involving a secret team, quote unquote.
It's because you're paying to do it.
I'm not
your
paid
organization.
To do it. I looked into this independently, and I found out that there's nothing to these charges.
Oh,
and
really?
In fact, the New York Times and other major media have looked into the same charges and have admitted there's nothing to them. They cannot be substantiated. So the point is, Mr. Sheehan is continuing with his suit against Secord, Singlaub, Rob Owen, Adolfo Calero, another former CIA official, Theodore Shackley, who served his country for 25 years, lawful activities. He's finding himself dragged through the mud by the Christic Institute people. It's an outrage, and it's got to stop.
Jackson, New Jersey, you're on the air.
Hi, I have a comment and then a question for Mr. Sheehan.
All right, go ahead.
Mr. Sheehan, I was listening to WNCA the other day, last week. Mike Siegel had a program on with the Bani Sada and the head of the Sabak from Iran when the Shah was in. Now, I heard that whole program, and I called the Christic Institute in Washington, and I told them about the program. So he asked me, what program, where it is, and he got in touch with them, and they were on yesterday. The Christic Institute was on Mike Siegel's program yesterday. But another thing I want to ask you, there was a woman that wrote a book from CBS, I can't think of her name, all about this whole thing. Now, I understand that, I wanted to know if you have any information back from 1980. I understand the Republicans took a poll right before the election, and it looked like Jimmy Carter was going to win. If those prisoners had been let out, that was the only thing that did not allow him to become president again. And I understand that Carter found out that Israel was sent weapons to Iran, and he got very, very upset, and he sent Warren Christopher.
Caller, I need a question from you, please.
I want to know if he knows of anything about this, because this girl that wrote this book said she met Jody Powell at a party and asked him about this whole thing.
Okay, why don't you hold right there and we'll find out the answer. Thanks for the question.
Okay. The book you're talking about, ma'am, is this book called Out of Control. It's written by Leslie Colburn, who's a producer for CBS, West 57th Street. It's like 60 Minutes for West 57th Street. That all people have to do is buy the book and read it to find out the details of this information. This is not a mystery, this information. They can also buy a book called The Iran-Contra Connection by Professor Peter Dale Scott and Jonathan Marshall and Ms. Hunter. That it sets out detailed information about this stuff. They can buy Bob Woodward's book called Veil that talks in details about these operations that are going on. See, Mr. Kincaid would have one believe that this is somehow a mystery, that no one knows about what this is that's going on. The fact of the matter is that this is information that's going to be proven in court, that's going to be established by a jury in Miami. Now, this other information about what the caller was talking about was there's some information floating around indicating that there may have been some communications that went on behalf of Bill Casey when he was not the CIA director, but prior to that time when he was the director of the campaign for President Reagan. And prior to the election, there's some information indicating that there was contact going on between the campaign structure of President Reagan and the Iranians to try to strike some sort of deal that those hostages not be released. We don't know about that information. We've heard about the information. We have not pursued the information. And so we can't say. There is some information around, and obviously it's being investigated by journalists and others, and they may find out one way or another what happened there.
Well,
I don't know what the answer
is. The Colburn book is interesting because it was rushed into print so quickly in order to cash in on the Iran-Contra affair that it doesn't even have a table of contents or an index.
Proving what?
And the footnotes aren't even numbered, so it's impossible to check the sources, if any, of various statements in the book. Now, I can understand why Danny here wants to promote the book, because the book promotes you.
It talks about our investigation.
It promotes you as a great authority.
Tell them what you think about CBS, Cliff.
What do I think?
What a communist, you know, propaganda machine CBS is.
Well, I'll speak for myself.
Why don't you go ahead and do that? Why don't you go ahead and do it? You're speaking for someone else.
The question about that Danny keeps raising about profiteering and corruption. Well, what about books like this that attempt to cash in and make money off of the Iran-Contra affair? What about the fact that the Christic Institute has been engaging in extrajudicial publicity, pretrial publicity, which is, in the opinion of some legal experts, unethical? They have a Contragate video out featuring Danny Sheehan for $35. I guess you've dropped the price down to $20, but you've got an audio...
So you could afford it, Cliff.
An audio tape. I wouldn't buy it.
I've got an audio tape
because I've read some of your other free material.
Oh, good. I'll send you some more.
They've got an audio tape for $10. They got resources. He's on television and radio. He's making, he and his associates finding businesses booming for them. Meanwhile, the defendants are facing ruinous legal costs as much as millions of dollars and facing perhaps bankruptcy.
Okay, we've got a caller that's been waiting.
Why don't you have Richard Secord dig out some of the $8 million and use it for his defense?
Puyallup, Washington, thank you for waiting so long. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Mr. Kincaid a couple of questions, quick questions, and then a short comment.
Okay.
First question is, how much does United Fruit pay you, and how long have you been a right-wing McCarthyite? And to Mr. Sheehan, I would say congratulations, Mr. Sheehan. Stay in there and keep up the good fight. And I'd like to extend an invitation to Mr. Kincaid, like North did to Abu Nidal. I'm 55 years old, but I'd like to have 10 minutes in the alley with you.
Okay, thank you for the
call. Well, it's hard to know how to respond to that, but since Danny here was in the process of plugging people who promote him, let me just say in regards to the Moyers program that Accuracy and Media has just done a newsletter detailing the many flaws in that Moyers report. And for Danny to put Bill Moyers up as a great authority, this is the man, after all, who approved wiretaps on Martin Luther King Jr. I'm sure you know that.
There's been lots of discussion in this program about information that either of these groups has. We have both of the addresses for the organizations. Both are located here in Washington. We have about 20 minutes left in this program, certainly not enough time to take the questions that are on the line. We'll put those addresses on the screen several times over the next few minutes so you can copy them down. If you didn't get a chance to get through on the air, you have a chance to talk to these groups and get more information. Let's go to Baltimore next. Good evening.
Yes, good evening. I have a short comment and then a question.
Okay.
My first comment addressed to Mr. Kincaid. I believe that your motives are so transparently clear that you're pretty laughable. But to Mr. Sheehan, is it true that the special prosecutor Walsh got in contact with you the very first day or the day after he came in town to investigate the various allegations involved in the Iran-Contra affair?
Okay, let me ask you before I let you go. You've said Mr. Kincaid has transparent motives. I think you ought to at least give him something to respond to.
Well, for example, pretty much the entire show has been involved pretty much bashing the Christic Institute without really addressing the serious questions involved in their lawsuit, and that hasn't really been brought out to the people. So Mr. Kincaid's offense has just been to attack the Institute without really addressing the serious questions involved in the lawsuit, and he kind of glosses over the fact that they have not lost any of the cases that they've been involved in.
Okay, thank you for the comments.
Well,
let's start with the Walsh, and we'll come back to you from there.
Yeah, the answer is yes, that Mr. Walsh's staff, in fact, was in communication with me the day he came into town and had staff members, investigators at our office the very next day dealing with the information. We provided information to them. We were willing to provide sources to them so that they could investigate these people as long as they could assure protection. And they did assure protection when they decided they wanted to interview any of these people. We brought sources to them and spoke with them. They've interviewed a number of people. A number of these people, in fact, their names have been given to the defendants. And that there are approximately, out of the 79 sources that were listed in our affidavit, there are approximately 12 that the defendants don't have, for your information, Mr. Kincaid. That these are people who, in fact, we've asked for protection for, and the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals has entered an emergency stay, allowing us not to reveal that information, because there's been a regular pattern of harassment and intimidation against these people by the people here that you're representing. Now, that's the nature of the problem, and what the gentleman asks is that you respond to the substance of the charges. Fact is that we charge that there was this underground network to provide the military equipment in violation of the law. We've named the people that were participating. Oliver North and Dick Secord have acknowledged the accuracy of the information. We've pointed out the drug smuggling that's been going on. It's been pointed out now in detail, the names of the people that have been involved. Witnesses have been provided to the United States Congress. The Senate Foreign Relations Committee has investigated. The Crime Subcommittee of the House Judiciary Committee is investigating these charges at the present time. You know, this is what's going to be going on. And it does no good to get up on national television and flap around and try to assert that there's nothing to this.
Okay, why don't you let him respond?
Well, first of all, as I say, major media organizations, not only myself, have tried to look into the allegations in his conspiracy theory and have failed to find any evidence to back them up. So the question becomes, what is the political purpose of this lawsuit? And I've already gone into that. There was, obviously, a private aid network for the Nicaraguan freedom fighters. But there has been no determination as of yet that there was anything inherently illegal about that. It was a covert operation being run by people who thought that it was not only legal but moral. And I think they came to the aid of the freedom fighters at a time when Congress had not fulfilled its responsibilities. So that's the issue. That's the question. And why doesn't Danny Sheehan, after 18 months, finally, where's the beef?
Okay, let's go to Honolulu next. We have 15 minutes left in our program. Good evening.
Hi, my call is for Dan Sheehan.
Okay.
I'd really like to thank you for exposing this tip of the secret assassination squad iceberg. I agree with everything that you brought out, and I'm really glad about it as far as the Contra drug dealing and the whole slimy business. But one thing I haven't heard talked about, and I wondered if you had, is if you recall, before we took over Grenada, we couldn't do it because there was a popular leader there, Prime Minister Bishop, who was well-liked by his people and the neighboring countries, and we were only able to go in there after he was murdered. I wondered if you heard anything about whether North and the gang had anything to do with that.
No, I haven't.
Okay.
Well, if I could add something going back, there are many references by some of the callers, including by Danny Sheehan here, about Colonel North. Colonel North is not a defendant in the suit, even though he is featured prominently in Christic Institute literature. And he's savagely attacked as the person through which this so-called secret team worked. If North is supposed to be so involved in all this, why isn't he a defendant?
It's quite the contrary, Cliff. The fact of the matter is that all that Oliver North was the liaison from the administration to the secret team. This team was in operation before Oliver North was ever in office. They helped set up the Contras in secret meetings that with Anastasio Somoza after he fled from Nicaragua in July of 1979. We know where the meetings were held. We know some of the people that were in the meetings, where they ended up agreeing that the secret team of Shackley, Secord, Kleins, and Hakim would supply military equipment to the military commanders of Somoza. We've given the times and dates of the meetings. You know, the fact of the matter is that there is evidence abounding here. And for you to suggest that no one has concluded they've committed criminal acts, all through the final select committee report, they state over and over again that these men violated statute after statute after statute. What they said is that they did not attempt to reach the question of whether or not there was criminal intent in violating all of these statutes. We have asserted in our lawsuit that there was criminal intent. It was full knowledge of what they were doing, and they hoped to get away with it, and they didn't.
The fact of the matter is, you saying it so doesn't make it so.
No, but my proving it in court does make it so.
Even though you make much and your friends make much of alleged Contra drug smuggling, the fact of the matter is, which you also know but don't want to talk about, the House Iran-Contra Committee conducted a massive investigation of these charges and concluded that the Contra leadership was not involved in drug trafficking and no official U.S. government agencies were involved. So a main part of his allegations have been looked into by the Congress and dismissed as without foundation.
That's a big, fat lie, to use a legal term. The fact of the matter is Birmingham wrote a memo saying that the Select Committee had investigated it. It had not. Not one single interview was conducted by one single member of the Select Committee into the narcotics matters. We met with them, we provided information for them, and they said they were not looking into that. That's not true at all.
You can't provide the evidence.
The Senate Foreign Relations Committee is holding hearings on this now, and the House Committee is also looking into it.
Mr. Sheehan, we have to take a call. Yeah. You have a quick response?
No,
first. Okay, let's go to Atlanta, Georgia next. Good evening.
Hello?
You're on the air, sir.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Mr. Sheehan. Apparently, the Christic Institute has been investigating apparently harassing the Kuz, General Sinlov, for their patriotic help to the freedom fighters.
No,
and
suing
my comment
him. Suing him, not harassing
that
him.
We would be in a very sad fix in this country if the French hadn't come to our aid in our little revolution. And why has he not, or does he not think it advisable, to investigate the many hundreds of people in this country that have donated millions of dollars to the Sandinistas? It's rather difficult for me to understand where he's coming from. And I'd like to clear up one other little thing he said. If I'm not mistaken, he said that the Catholic bishops were negative as far as the support of the Contras. Well, as I understand it, right at the end of the bishops' meetings, when most of the Roman Catholic bishops had left, a small group that were left there of the progressive and modernist bishops voted that on a voice vote. And I do not think it represents the majority of the Roman Catholic bishops of the United States. But I would like to why Mr. Sheehan does not and has not perhaps investigated the other people that donate money to the Sandinistas.
Okay, thanks for the call.
It's easy to answer it. The fact of the matter is, sir, that the United States Catholic Bishops Conference has testified at least six times in its formal resolutions passed by a full voting majority of the people with a full quorum available of the United States Catholic Conference bishops to oppose the aid to the Contras. They have said so. They've testified about it. It's not some small group of people who met in secret after everyone else had left. You know, that's based on an abysmal lack of information that you have. It's a matter of formal policy on the part of the bishops. With regard to the, we've answered the other question before, is that the people who've supplied medical assistance to people in the government of Nicaragua have done so openly, legally, in full view of the whole world. They provide medical assistance to these people in food and supplies and schooling, schooling equipment. These people that we're suing, not harassing, suing, have been providing lethal military equipment to the former military commanders of Somoza, the military dictator. And that is a fundamentally different thing. That is illegal. It's in violation of the Arms Export Control Act. It's in violation of customs laws. It's in violation of several criminal statutes. The fact of the matter is we will prove it in court, we will set forth the evidence, and they will be convicted.
Well, the reason, obviously, that Danny doesn't want to investigate the private aid network for the Sandinistas and the communists in Central America is that he used to work for the group that's involved in sending the private aid down to the communists.
It doesn't require any investigation.
And furthermore,
if they're doing it in public view, everybody knows about it.
It certainly does, because the Iran-Contra committees held hearings on conservative fundraising for the Nicaraguan freedom fighters. In fact, two minor players in the Iran-Nicaragua affair have pleaded guilty to illegal fundraising. But the minority report of the Iran-Contra committees points out that Democrats in Congress have been raising funds for the communists in Central America, including the Sandinistas, doing virtually the same thing, supporting the other side, and they're getting away with it.
Boulder, Colorado, good evening.
Hello.
You're on the air, sir.
I think your show was great. I think it ought to be watched by everybody 24 hours a day. I just have a quick comment and a question for Danny Sheehan. I'm a student at the University of Colorado in Boulder. And recently, when the CIA was recruiting there, Danny Sheehan went on stage and convicted President Gordon Gee, the president of the university, of crimes against humanity for allowing the CIA to recruit there. And in doing so, attempting to block my constitutional right to get a job with the CIA. Danny Sheehan is spouting these lofty goals of constitutional rights. Why is he trying to block my constitutional rights of doing this?
Okay, thank you.
I'm not blocking your constitutional rights to do anything you want. You know right where Langley is. You can apply to work with the Central Intelligence Agency if you'd like. The fact of the matter is that I was asked to speak at the University of Colorado to talk about the issue of illegal covert operations. That is the position that we have taken repeatedly, that there are illegal covert operations being undertaken and that they have to be stopped. You know, that we believe that people can support our democracy, they can support our form of economic forms of government. We do not have to do this type of thing. We don't have to support these kind of midnight soldiers with secret funds and argue that the Congress is failing to meet its responsibility because 73% of the American people don't want them to give them a dime. That's a total lack of respect for the democratic process. That's a very different matter. We're saying that we're perfectly willing to debate this in public anywhere. We want the people to come up out of the dark, to come up out of the alleys and the shadows, and argue on behalf of their positions. I think that some of these defendants, in fact, are better than people would think. That General Singlaub, General Secor, all they have to do is get up front, admit exactly what it is they've done, and argue on behalf of what they've done. Not to lie about it, and destroy documents, and hide, and cajole. All they got to do is come up front and admit it. We can have a public debate about it. You say, when I pointed out to you that they were lying and publicly denying doing anything but humanitarian relief, that they were involved in a covert operation. This has been designated over and over again as not to have been any kind of official covert operation. The United States Congress, which is the government of our country, prohibited any covert operation to supply military equipment to these people. This was a criminal enterprise, not a covert operation.
Let me just make the point. What you're hearing here is basically opposition to covert operations against communists.
Illegal covert activities.
There's nothing illegal about these operations. The president has the right under our Constitution as commander-in-chief to carry them out. It's simply, from his perspective, he does not want to fight the communists.
The group is against all covert operations?
We're against illegal covert operations. And the question arises, there has to be a legal discussion in our Congress as to what the nature of the authorization is, where it came from, what the guidelines are. And there has been no such discussion.
You're listening to someone here who called for the impeachment of President Reagan after the Iran-Contra hearings concluded.
And before they began.
And before.
And tonight, all over the country called for his impeachment.
He has his mind made up about so many things, and the evidence is irrelevant.
The evidence is overwhelming,
what it is. Just 5 minutes left. Let's go to Brundage, Alabama next. Good evening.
Good evening. I was in Nicaragua and El Salvador in 1972, dove hunting with some friends of mine. And the National Guard down there really pushed us around. Like, one of them snuck up behind me while I was shooting doves on a mountaintop and knocked me to the ground, disarmed me, and put a BAR to the back of my head. And I understand a lot of my friends also had that same kind of treatment. And what I'd like for people to know, especially the ones here, is that if they'll treat American tourists down there like that, they'll treat their own people much, much worse. And the guy who disarmed me looked for all the world like a National Guard member in my own hometown up here, because he was using American equipment, American BAR, riding an American Jeep that was all supplied to him by our government. Now, what I don't think people get is that if they'll do that to their people for 40 or 50 years, there's nothing in the world that we can send down there at this point to save them.
Okay, thank you for the call. Appreciate it. Mr. Sheehan?
Well, it's important that people understand that when this occurred, 1972, it was Anastasio Somoza, who was the military dictator down there, being supplied by the Pentagon and others with this military equipment. The reason that he was cut off from all military supplies from the United States in October of 1977 was because there was a finding by the Congress and the President of the United States that Anastasio Somoza was engaged in a systematic violation of the human rights of his own citizenry. He was cut off from military equipment, and it was these people, it was Shackley, Secord, Kleins, Hakim, and these others through the Egyptian American Transport and Service Company, after they had been pushed out of the United States government because of their activities, who began to supply military equipment to Somoza in total violation of U.S. policy. And even after he fell from power and fled to Norman Kay in 1979, they met with him again, continued to supply the military equipment to him to attack that government, which has been declared a criminal operation by the World Court.
Okay, response.
Well, look, all of these defendants can speak for themselves. All I've attempted to do, and successfully, I might add, rebut these allegations, I'm trying to do is look at the impact that his suit is having on some of the defendants who, as far as I can determine, are completely innocent of the charges and who are being abused by the legal system under the direction of Danny Sheehan.
2 minutes left, 90 seconds. Time for a quick comment from Eugene, Oregon.
All right. Aaron, can you turn that off, please? I would like to first say to Mr. Sheehan that there
quickly,
are literally
sir.
Thousands of us here in Eugene who are following what you're doing with great enthusiasm, and we're realizing what a tremendous monster you're up against.
Okay, we need a question.
Is that me?
No, I don't think it's Mr. Kincaid.
Yeah, I want to congratulate you.
Okay.
And to Mr. Cliff Kincaid, I would like to say, sir, that you are a liar. And I would appreciate it if you would simply pack your bags and leave.
Okay, well, we're almost out of time. How about a response?
Well, look, I'm not paid by United Fruit. I'm not a liar. Some guy wanted to get me in an alley. Look.
I apologize on behalf of all of us for that.
Yeah,
I disagree with
these
that.
These are the kind of people
I just
guess
like
that,
to get you on the air,
that
just
you
like
attract.
This, to show that you don't know what you're talking
I'm
about.
I'm glad I finally have a chance to get on the air, because he's gotten on all the radio and TV programs spreading all his disinformation, and no one has successfully been able to challenge him because he's got the media in large part wrapped around his finger.
And you
and
don't
I
know
urge
what the
people,
facts are.
I know the
That's
facts,
your
and I've looked at your
Where'd you get
looked
the facts?
At your lawsuit.
Where'd you get
you
the
don't
facts?
Have the evidence to back up what you
we
say. Are
what
facts.
Do, where do the
so
40 or 50
I encourage
names
people
from?
To look at yeah. my analysis of what his suit is doing, because his target is the consolidation of a communist regime in Nicaragua. That's his goal.
We are out of time. I want to thank both of our guests for being with us this evening. Danny Sheehan, Chief Counsel of the Christic Institute in Washington, D.C. The address will be on the screen if you have more to say to him after this program. Cliff Kincaid, who is Director of Media Analysis at Accuracy Media here in Washington. Gentlemen, thank you for being with us this evening.
Thank you very much, Susan.
Appreciate your comments. Have a good evening.
If you'd like up-to-date C-SPAN program schedule information 24 hours a day, please dial 202-628-2205. C-SPAN program schedule information is available 24 hours a day at 202-628-2205.
You're watching C-SPAN, America's network. C-SPAN is a nonprofit cooperative created and supported by